In this part two of our lecture, we are taking the SLP filed by the Innovative Industries Limited, civil appeal number 10719 of 18. Following appeals were there against the order of the NCLAT. One is that is filed by the erstwhile chairman and managing director of that IIL. He was holding 23.2% of the shares, voting shares. Second is the workers unions of IIL. They have first challenged the order of the NCLT Mumbai, challenging the liquidation ordered by them because of the voting share being less than 75%. They had gone to they filed a writ petition before the Honorable Mumbai High Court and with a direction to Union of India for revival of this company, as there is a, and dispensing with the mandatory 75%. In other words, they wanted that shortfall is just 8%, and therefore that particular shortfall can be dispensed in this case because it involves life of so many employees. And also they took a stand that the company was doing well even after the initiation of CIRP process, during which period they achieved a turnover of 334 crores and a revenue of 125 crores. We are not clear what is this revenue and what is this turnover from the judgment, but I am reading out whatever it is there. And they also paid indirect taxes of 9 crores roughly. And so they wanted the dispensing because they must, it is a right to life for employees like that they have gone through. Now, the what is the case of this IIL? The resolution plan was rejected by the financial creditors holding 33% voting share. The resolution professional preferred a petition and informed the NCLT bench about the rejection of the resolution plan, which means there was no resolution plan and the CIRP period has come to 270 days. Therefore, the NCLT bench, interpreting the code as it is, this ordered for liquidation. And the MD first filed a petition before the Honorable NCLT Mumbai, seeking a direction to the dissenting financial creditor to disclose why they have rejected the plan, imputing malafide intentions to the financial creditors who have rejected. The reasons and basis for such decision-making process must be brought into that. Further, he raised the issue that when you are dissenting without giving reasons and you are not participating in the voting, then why should the voting share should be considered? The voting share of them should not be considered. That was the argument put before them. And Mumbai, they not even asked for response from the respondents. Notice was not issued, and they purely went by the book law. That is, 75% resolution plan should be approved by 75% of the financial creditor having voting share. And if that is not there within that 270 days, the adjudicating authority has to go by the strict interpretation of the law. So, because it is a code, it has to be interpreted as per, that is why it has become code. So, now there will be a lot of conflicting discussions. What is the object of the code? Object of the code is, you see that the company survives. The liquidation is the last resort. You must get maximum realizations to the creditors. That is why this is taken over. The assets have been, the control and management is transferred to the creditors. That is the first step. And they don't give the same promoters who are indulging in mismanagement that resulted in this default and the CIRP process. That is another objective was there. So when you say the objective of the business is to is surviving business, why do you want to liquidate? Now, whether should be interpreted in line with the objective of the code, or which should be letter and spirit of the court is the continuous conflict that is being presented before Supreme Court, is what my opinion is. So let's go further. Then now it is clear that part is already settled law, that we will see. We already discussed in the TSCO versus Liberty. So the workers union also filed petition appeal for opposing the liquidation, and the RP also filed an application praying him to allow submit an alternative resolution plan. This one is done in NCLT, sorry. The NCLT, as I told you, did not call for response from the respondent and proceeded with ordering the liquidation and to reject the petitions. So then the decision of NCLAT, in one case this confirmed the order of the Mumbai bench, in another case turned down the order of the Hyderabad bench. Both these appeals were taken together, and Honorable Supreme Court has now starts discussions on the what are the issues presented before them, and that is what I am now going to take. The senior counsel appearing for Kamineni took the following grounds. You see, at that point in time, there was a proposal to reduce the voting share from 75% to 66%. But the same was amended in 23rd. The amendment, it came into force only on 23rd November 2017. The resolution was voted in October. That means at the time resolution was put to vote, the amendment was there, but it was not a proposal to amend, reducing the 75% voting share to 66% was there, but then it was not amended. But at the time of delivering the judgment of NCLAT, that has become a law. That is the point. And normally that means that they are trying to agitate and plead before the Honorable Supreme Court to consider that at least, so that they will be complying with that 75%. The simple is there. Suppose the 33% persons who voted, they have not come. So that means 67% only came. It is not 75%, it was dismissed. Now my case is, you have 67% of the voting share present fully, 33 not there, ignore 33. That means 100% voting has taken place. Understand, that is how the interpretation, now it is approved. That is a clear cut interpretation. But at that point in time, they were pleading for that to be considered, so that you can achieve the objective at the same time, respect the. Now coming to this, they are pleading for that particular interpretation. It should be a beneficial interpretation, and the law is such, it should be made to work. On that grounds, it has been taken up for this thing. Then, second thing, they say also taken the decision that why don't you look it from the retrospective angle? That is, at the time when the, they voted for resolution rejecting that particular thing, we should have taken 66% because that proposal was pending before that time. And they also assailed that NCLAT, which decided the appeals on 6th September, how to have taken into account the changed provision calling for 66%. So they pleaded for a retroactive interpretation. Now for that, they have relied upon several issues, judgments of the Honorable Supreme Court. So the reliance is, you can discuss, you can read in the page 19 of the order. Section 30, subsection 4. They want to prove that it applies to pending proceedings. Proceedings which are pending at the time when the law was to, law is yet to make, the law has come to existence little later, but then it was under proposal. At that point in time, these provisions, these actions have taken place. So instead of 75%, we should apply 66%. This is the first step. In that, they have given the citations. Venkatakrishnam Raju versus Union of India, to Government of India versus Indian Tobacco Association, and Zail Singh versus State of Haryana. These three cases were cited to buttress their argument that when the decision was taken, the amended provisions were in existence, though not amended. So the force of law has not come into them, but then that became force of law little later. So therefore, that should be also given due consideration, retroactive amendment. Now, the second ground they have taken a citation was applicability of section 238A, that is with regard to Limitation Act. So there was a lot of discussion about this Limitation Act, as we all know, whether it will apply the law from this inception of this code from 2016, or it will apply from the original. That law is at rest. Honorable Supreme Court very clearly said that 238 will be retroactive. It will apply from the beginning. And this is, we have taken up Mithilesh Kumari. This judgment for BK Educational Services Private Limited versus Parag Gupta and Associates, where the Honorable Supreme Court considered the applicability of Section 238 inserted by way of same amendment in the INB Code with effect from 6th June 2018. In this decision, the court held that legislative intent behind the amendment was to apply the Limitation Act from the very beginning to NCLT and NCLET while deciding the applications filed under Section 7 and 9 of INB Code, and the appeals therefrom. Reliance is placed. Next is with regard to Section 14.3 of the Code, wherein this was a surety of in a contract of guarantee for a corporate debtor. The court held that the amendment was retrospective, and that was discussed in this Rustom and Hornby India Limited versus TB Kadom. So this is a retrospective case is there. They further went to Section 2A of the Industrial Dispute Act, citing that it is also retrospective interpretation in Bharat Singh versus Management of New Delhi Tuberculosis Center, New Delhi. So they try to assail that they plead that it is to be interpreted in that way. Then we will be in a position to come clean on that. So that was the judgments.